Good morning.
Good morning.
Is the Lord worthy of our praise this morning?
Yes.
This is a song where it's like a call and answer. We've done this before, this song. I ask you a question. Do you feel the world is broken? And you're going to answer, we do. And so it'll all be up on the screen. Why don't we stand and sing together? Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? Won't stop the light from getting through. We do. And do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do. And is all creation groaning? And is a new creation coming? Thank you.
worthy of all of our praise and honor and worship. He is worthy of all that we have and all that we are. And He is worthy for us today to do more than sing, to do more than sit, to do more than stand. But He is worthy for us to surrender all that we have and all that we are to Him. That's, I think, the greatest act of worship that we could ever give to God. Just to give Him all that we are and say, God, I'm yours. Lay it all down, give it all up, and let it all go. That's what we should do. Not always that easy, right? Well, it is good to join together in worship. It's good to see everybody today. What a great way to start affirming our faith in Christ and the worth of God to receive all of our worship. I have a few announcements to share, and some of these are in your bulletin. Please remember that during the summer we are encouraging block parties. And a block party can be a neighborhood party, it can be a small party, it can be a big party, it can be whatever level you'd like to make it. Don't be afraid thinking, if I have a block party, I have to invite everybody in the, you know, Crawford County or something like that. But it's inviting people around your neighborhood. It's planning a get-together where you have something outdoors in your backyard, grill some hot dogs, have some ice cream, nurture some relationships, and connect with people. And that's our goal, is to connect with people that we haven't really connected with before. And so I'd like to encourage you to be thinking about that. We do desire to have some home groups to start up again in September or after the summer. And hopefully, Lord willing, that'll be from some of the people we met at our block parties. There's a purpose in those two, and they're connected. So there is a sign-up sheet and out in the missionary literature counter out there. You can sign up if you're interested. It doesn't say I'll do it, but if you're interested, and I would like to talk to you about it. And also, please take this little kit. This sort of points out how you can have a block party, no matter how small you want to make it, no matter how extravagant you want to be or don't want to be. This just kind of helps you see that it's not really as overwhelming as it may sound. So, block parties. Another thing that we have coming up, and it's this Saturday, and it is our bicycle clinic and free giveaways. And it's during the Sagertown Yard Sale this Saturday, and our bike clinic is from 9 till 3. I'm not sure exactly the hours of the Sagertown Yard Sale itself. But we will be giving away free bicycles. Our refurbished bikes are up to about 19 right now. They should be about 25 by Saturday that are ready to give away to kids. We've been working on those. And we have some new bikes that are going to be donated. We're going to give away some helmets and things like that to registered kids for a drawing. And please remember, at 2 o'clock, what time?
2 o'clock.
I will have a brief gospel message, 3 to 4 minute gospel message on the sidewalk during the bike clinic. And then we will give away our free brand new bikes. And every kid rides off on an illustration of the good grace of Jesus. How do you like that? So everybody's happy that day. Kids are smiling. Families are happy. And we give away snow cones during that time also. So we have a sign-up sheet for the bicycle clinic help. And that's out here also on the missionary literature table. Please sign up for how you would like to be involved in that. If you think, I can't do anything, then there's something wrong with you. If you know how to sit in a chair and look at people as they go by, you're invited to come. Okay? We just need people from our church there so that when other people come, it's not the responsibility of all of us working on the bikes and things to try to talk to everybody, but that the church family is there interacting and engaging in conversation and talking with people. And we'll have some tracks to give away for those who feel comfortable doing so. But we need the church family there. Come and go throughout the day. You don't have to stay the whole time. Just show up. That's what we're looking for. So that is this Saturday, starting at 9 o'clock through 3 o'clock, and the bike giveaway is at 2 o'clock. That's when we really need everybody there, as much people as we can at one point. Very good. Another announcement. I got an assignment. I'm assigning you the responsibility of coming to the Embers meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. That's not in the bulletin. I accidentally left that out. But our Embers meeting is tomorrow at 7. And we would encourage all of you to be a part of that with us. And then finally, at the end of the service today, we will be having a vacation Bible school planning meeting, and we'll have that near the back of the sanctuary after the service, all right? So a lot of we need some help with that also, as that is being prepared, plans in the making, and that starts August the 7th. That will be here before we know it.
Pastor Jeff?
Yes?
Can I just mention a couple things? If you are interested in helping a VBS and you're not part of the core group, please come, because they still need crew leaders, I need craft helpers, and I need snack helpers. So if you're interested, please come or see me if you're not able to come, because I need you to get your clearances before the event if you don't have them on file at the church already. So make sure you see me today or come to the meeting afterwards. Also, the ladies have a sign-up sheet out there for a deep clean of the church over the summer. So if you could look, it's a two-page sign-up sheet. If there's anything on there you think you can do, just sign your name next to it. Just get it done sometime before Labor Day. So we don't have a cleaning crew that we pay, and so we want to do a deep clean of the church once or twice a year. Also, on July the 23rd, we're going to have a very special thing after church. Terry Hemlock and Becky Kurtz, we're going to be teaching about how to make tinctures and salves. Now you think, okay, how is that a church thing? Well, first of all, it's a great way of learning how to use God's nature to help heal ourselves, right? But we are also going to use these tools for Light in Bethlehem. So if you're interested in participating in that, let's say you can't be, you can't be part of the crew at Light in Bethlehem, you can provide us some of these tinctures and salves if you learn how to make them over the summer. And summertime is the best time to do that. So I'd invite you to come right after church on the 23rd of July.
Very good. What was the first one?
First what?
Tinctures.
Tinctures.
I've learned a new word today. I still don't know what it means.
Come and find out.
A tincture has something to do with an ointment or salve, I guess. All right. Well, wonderful. Plenty of opportunity for everybody to be involved, right? I'd like to invite you to stand with me. This morning, we're going to unite our hearts in prayer and invite the Lord not to work in Joe's life or Sally's life, but to work in my life and in our own personal lives today. Lord, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we are thankful, Lord, that you were a part of our life in the worst part of our week. You were a part of our life, and we encountered you in that time of difficulty. Lord, the decisions that need to be made this week that were frustrating and stressful, when some didn't know the right choice to make, Lord, you were right there with them. And they encountered your peace, your strength, and your guidance, whether they realize it or not. Lord, we woke up in your blessing as recipients of your grace this morning. We have encountered you from the moment we woke up until the moment we walked through this door today, Lord. And we thank you that you're such a part of our lives. Forgive us for not even thinking about some of the smaller ways that you show yourself faithful to us. Lord, today we want to invite you, Lord Jesus Christ, to come into every heart and every life, to fill us with a sense of your presence. Lord, that we would feel your Holy Spirit opening our heart and filling our heart full of your love for you, for Jesus, for one another, for those who are still outside of your family. Lord, please work in our hearts and our lives today. Change us into the people that you want us to be, that would be honoring and glorifying to you in everything we say and everything we do. And we commit this time to you, Lord, may you be rightfully and gloriously exalted today in our worship. And we'll thank you for all that you have done and all that you are going yet to do in this church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, all he wants is all of you. Are you willing to give him all? Boy, that's hard, isn't it? But we're going to sing about it today, and by faith, we're going to hand him all, okay?
Still outside of the family, when we have these missions projects, we are connecting with future family members that just aren't in God's family yet. And that just does something to my head and my heart. We're connecting with people who are future, going to be some of the future family members of the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we do what we do, especially during the summer. We run ourselves ragged during the summer. But it's outreach, trying to connect with others in our community so that we can connect them to Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior and be gloriously forgiven, gloriously saved, and gloriously brought into God's family. It's a great thing to be involved in. Well, thank you again, and thank whoever put that video together. That was a great, inspiring video. Well, before we go to our time of prayer, we would like to have a time of praise. So if God has shown himself faithful in your life this week, we'd like to hear from you. How has God shown himself faithful? How have you encountered God this week? And we'd like to invite you to share with us. Brother Glenn.
Last night I got to watch some people that study prophecy, and they were discussing there are so many hidden nuggets in the Word of God that speak volumes to Jews because that's their culture. And Jesus, in discussing with Philip said, "We don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." That was a Jewish, in the Jewish temple had three doors. They were named the way, the truth, and the life. So Jesus was making that observation, "I'm the way to the Father, to the Holy of Holies."
So they couldn't have missed that.
They would know for sure.
Well, thank you for that point.
That's very interesting. Thank you, Brother Glenn. Anybody else have a reason to praise the Lord? Lois.
Well, I was due to have a visit with my great-granddaughter from Kentucky, but they had to put it off for a week. But instead of being disappointed, I was excited because they decided to stay home because she wanted to go to Vacation Bible School. And that's how I became a Christian, by the seeds planted Vacation Bible School. So my great-granddaughter is going to Vacation Bible School this year.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Absolutely. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Any other praise reports? Oh, look what I found on this pew over here. Yes.
I just had an update on our neighbor, Jim. He had went down to Pittsburgh for another treatment plan for his lymphoma that came back because the chemo wasn't working. And after a long road, he's back home and informed us he had his follow-up PET scan, and he's cancer-free. So he appreciates all the prayers, and we're very happy to hear that, and he's praising God.
Thank you. So make sure you scratch that off on your prayer thing right there. Healed. Answered. All right? Very good.
I'm just thankful that the Lord still continues to use our farm. And yesterday we had some Hindus that have been coming to our farm for a number of years come for the last time. They're moving to Texas, and they were excited to be there and then kind of sad to be leaving. But the cool thing he said was, well, which I thought was cool, he said, "I just sense like a certain spirit here." And I'm like, "Yeah, the Holy Spirit." But I was just like able to share a little bit with him, not as much as I'd like, but I mean, the Lord gives me these opportunities, so even if it's a little, I pray. And we're praying for them daily anyhow, and I just pray that the Lord would reveal this himself, his Holy Spirit, to them, and that they would see and believe. And then this Thursday, the rabbi is coming, so another prayer for him, because he's been coming for almost 9 years now, so continued talks there, too.
Wonderful. Thank you, Chris. We're thankful for 86 Acres, a great example of a missions outpost right here in our own community. Yes, Shannon.
We had a belated 4th of July party last night with Pathfinders, and I just thought it would be cool to share that we had three new first-time visitors, which is awesome.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Good. That's what that's all about. Good. We're thankful for our Pathfinders, our young adults, And by the way, the last Sunday of this month, Lord willing, fifth Sunday is going to be Mission Sunday, and the Pathfinders are going to have a video and some pictures and things like that. And hopefully we'll have some more of the crew here, maybe some more of that team can be here with us. So you're going to, well, that'll be an extended missions moment, missions a day. You'll love it. You're going to have a great time. Any others?
Yes, we have been praying for a place for our daughter to find a home somewhere. She has found a place to live. She doesn't have much to put in it, but you know how it goes. The years go by, you fill up your house somehow. But we just praise God that she is just so happy now because she doesn't want to live with us any longer because it's a pain that she's... But also, her chemo is going okay, but her magnesium level is not, it's not staying where it should be. And so she has to have a lot of magnesium transfusions. But I just praise God that we all have the patience for him because it's in his time, not ours. We always think it's in our time, but it's not. It's when he says it's right, and we don't try to control over our Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Bill. And that's Deb or Jody?
Jody.
Okay, Jody, daughter Jody. Any others? Ted, was that a hand?
Yes, I'd like to say, I saw a film this week that entitled The Sound of Freedom. I didn't know about it. Janelle said, let's go see this movie, and I said, okay. It's one of those movies that you need to see. It took 5 years in the making before it could be released. They hit roadblock after roadblock. But once you see the film, you know why they hit these roadblocks. God's trying to use this film to awaken this nation to what's happening in our nation and around the world, especially the children. It focuses on children in this movie. All I can say is you need to see it. It's going to be there till Thursday in the movies in Meadville. And that's what I have to say.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Ted. Sound of Freedom. Because Ted said to me, and Faith had also mentioned it, we went to see it also, and it's one of those movies that you won't like it, but everybody needs to see it. I'll just tell you, it's on sex trafficking. Sex trafficking. And we don't hear much about that, but with all the sex trafficking in the world today, the number one top place where sex traffickers arrive, United States of America. So we would encourage you to go see that. They don't have a lot of money behind this movie as far as advertisements and things like that. So after the movie, there was one of the actors urged everybody that's viewing the film to try to urge others to go see the film. And so it's still in the movies in Meadville for a while. I don't know how long. But it's called Sound of Freedom. And it is an... It is a wonderful movie, unfortunately, but it's a wonderful eye-opening movie that every Christian ought to go see that. Thank you, Ted, very much for mentioning that. Well, Reverend Beam, we're going to invite you to come and lead us in prayer.
Once again, we have a lot to be thankful for, don't we? God is answering prayer.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Cancer is not too difficult for our God.
Amen.
Aren't you thankful for that?
Amen.
Sometimes we tremble when we hear that word, but our God is bigger than cancer. Thank you for sharing that testimony, and we rejoice that God is hearing our prayers. here in Sagerton, and we're going to continue to believe God to minister and meet in a special way.
Yes.
Gracious Lord, we thank you from the bottom of our hearts for this wonderful testimony shared today of this healing of cancer. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the answer to prayer at 86 acres. And that, Lord, people are aware that there's something different about these 86 acres. Holy Spirit, continue to work there, I pray. And as Rabbi comes to get milk,
yes.
Oh, Holy Spirit, work in his heart.
Yes.
Minister in a special way, we pray. And continue to use this for your honor. Use this for your glory. Thank you, Lord. We do pray for Jody. Thank you that you've provided for her an apartment. Thank you, Lord. You can provide what she needs for in it too, Lord. You're able, and we thank you. And Lord, you know the physical. You know all about her situation. And we're believing God, you're going to work in such a way that Jody's going to know it's God that has done the work in her life.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus, move, we pray. Minister in a very special way, and we'll thank you. Lord, we want to pray for our vacation Bible school that's coming up. Thank you, Lord, that we have this opportunity to reach out into the community to precious children that need the Lord. Lord, we need these children. Draw them by your Spirit here, we pray. Might we have a church filled with children singing and giving praise to the Lord and receiving Christ as our Lord and Savior. We pray, Lord, that you would provide the workers that will be needed to make this possible. And, oh, Lord, more than anything else, we pray, Holy Spirit, move in this vacation Bible school. Just move in a very special way. Touch these precious children, some that have never been churched. Oh God, work, we pray. Minister, and we'll thank you. We'll give you praise. Lord, we want to remember this coming week, Dorothy White's having surgery on those eyes, on that eye. We thank you for what you did with the other one, that she's seeing so well, and we're believing, Lord, that everything is going to go especially well for that surgery as well. Lord, we're believing for a complete healing of that eye. Lord, take away any anxiousness. Give her an inner peace that passeth all understanding. We pray the same for Cindy as she goes for this surgery. Lord, would you just be with her? Guide those surgeons and doctors. Give them wisdom, Lord, and bring healing speedily to Cindy, we pray. And we'll thank you. Lord, we want to rejoice in the fact that there are new families coming into Pathfinders. Thank you for these new persons that have come. And we pray that you'll continue to work and move with our Pathfinders. Lord, do a special work in each one. Lead, direct, and guide in everything that they do. Lord, we're just going to thank you in advance. We pray for the bike clinic. Lord, that's coming up this coming Saturday. Lord, we want you to be honored and glorified in all that is done. There's been a lot of time spent on these bicycles, labors of love. But Lord, we want it to be more than a free bike. We want them to understand salvation. And may these precious children come to know you, Lord, we pray. Work at this very special event, we pray. Minister, Lord, to the hearts and the lives of those that are going to be there. Work, you know already who will be there. And we're just praying, God, you'll cause them. Don't let anything happen to hinder them from being there to hear the truth of the gospel one more time. Lord, we're so grateful for all that you're doing in our midst. These summer out activities bring a lot of extra work, but Lord, it's worth it if one soul comes into the kingdom of God. Oh Lord, use the efforts. Bless those that are going to sacrifice the time
for this very important ministry, and Lord will thank you. Oh God, I pray for every family in this church. You know every parent. You know every need in those families. I pray for the families where love is strong. And I pray for those families where it isn't strong. And ask you, God, to work in a very special way in those homes. We know, Jesus, you're the answer.
Yes.
And I pray, oh God, that you will work in those lives. You know each one, each husband, each wife, each child. And Lord, we're just praying that you'll move in a special way in every one of our families. Bring us closer to you, Lord. Bring us closer to you. Holy Spirit, continue to move in this service, we pray. Have your way in everything that's said and done. And we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
An ancient Irish hymn, one of the jewels of modern hymnody, still comes from this ancient hymn. Don't miss the words.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Do not be honest to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence, my Lord. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, true Son, thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. High King of heaven, my victory won, may I reach heaven's joy.
Children's have children's church today, right? All right. We hear the pitter-patter of little feet. So, you're walking downtown, or you've been at the fair, or you're at work, and it's lunchtime, it's break, or you're walking through the door of a business, and somebody walks up to you and steps up and says, how should I live? What would you tell them? Sounds simple enough, doesn't it? I bet you if we asked 10 people, how should you live, I bet we'd get 10 different answers. Sounds pretty easy, sounds pretty simple, but I'm not certain that we've come up with the right answer yet. How should we live is sort of closely aligned with why are we here? I'd say they're kind of related. Or, what's the purpose of life? You ever asked those questions and you ever come up with an answer? I have. I like what Billy Graham said. People come up to him, have come up to witness to Billy Graham. I don't know who that was, a blind person or something. I don't know, alien from another planet. But somebody was witnessing to Billy Graham someday and he said, what's the purpose of life? And Billy Graham was talking to this guy. He says, well, I know where I came from. I know what I'm doing here and I know where I'm going. Do you? And the guy was speechless. I don't know if you knew who Billy Graham was or not. I know where I came from. I know what I'm doing here. And I know where I'm going. Do you? I know what my life is about. I know why I'm here. I know how I'm supposed to live. Not because I came up with the right answer, because I've read it clearly in God's Word, the Bible. So hopefully we will learn a little bit today from the man by the name of Gideon in the Bible. Last week, we left Gideon as a peacemaker. And we learned a lot of things from Gideon as a peacemaker and our assignment. And I'm sure somebody may have done this. Our assignment, and I'm not going to ask you to hand this in. Wouldn't want to embarrass anybody, but the assignment was to pray this week, Lord, make me a peacemaker. Make me a peacemaker. That prayer. I hope you did that. I would like to say, did God answer that prayer for you? Or how did God answer that prayer for you? If he did, and you'd like to tell me about it, I'd love to hear from you. But today we're going to look at the question. Hopefully we'll get some information about how should we live. And we're looking at the life of Gideon. I want to also just add something to that. There's sort of a flip question. And that is, how should we not live? As we look at the life of Gideon. Judges chapter 8. We've been looking at Judges for some time now. We've been looking at the life of Gideon for some time. Judges is in the Old Testament. Sometimes we're not sure what to do with these Old Testament books, what part it plays in our life. Well, the New Testament has pretty clearly told us that these Old Testament stories and encounters with God are examples for us. There are examples for us to look back into these Old Testament passages and ask 2 to 3 questions. Should I live like that? Should I not live like that? Or thirdly, well then, Lord, how should I live? We can get those answers from the Old Testament, and that's what we're looking at with Gideon. Remember, Judges, again, is biblical history. It's a history book. There's not a lot of really commands in the book of Judges, like we might have in one of the epistles of Paul, where it's just like command galore in one of his writings. But biblical history is genuine history. Just because it's a Bible doesn't mean it's genuine history. So these books in the Bible are genuine historical books. And these historical books, specifically the book of Judges, records lifestyles, records activities, practices of some people and some groups. It records relationships that were proper or improper. It records events, experiences, etc. that are good or bad, right or wrong, some appropriate, some inappropriate. Some are clearly within God's will, others are clearly outside of God's will. That's what a history book does. A history book just doesn't put on all the good stuff. We want to leave a good impression in 100 years. People will open the book up and say, wow, what a great group of people these were. That's not why the book, that's not why history, biblical history at least, is written. It's so that people in 100 years or 2,000 years in the future can look back and say, wow, what a godly example. I want to live like, I'd like to live like Gideon did. Or, whoa, where did that come from? I'm pretty sure scripture doesn't agree with this. That's something I don't want to do. I want to steer clear of doing that. Lord, help me to not ever fall into that trap. And so that's what biblical history does. And as we look at biblical history, the history book in the Bible, we ask some questions. Is this behavior presented as proper or improper? And these are on the back panel, I believe, of your bulletin, if I remember correctly. Is this activity promoted or prohibited in other passages of Scripture? Does the New Testament shed any light on this Old Testament event? In other words, does Scripture help us interpret Scripture? Is this honoring to God, what's taking place or what I'm reading here? Does this honor the Lord? Is it in keeping with God's known will or His revealed truth? Does this biblical example present something good to follow or something to stay away from, example to avoid? So, remember, we're asking these questions not as Americans, but as Christians. Because how you look at it is liable to skew your answer that you come up with. So, as we look at this, we are looking at the person of Gideon and the question, how should we live? Someone approaches us or to ask us that question. If we are interested in honoring God with our lives, what answer are we going to come up with? So, Lord, as we look today into your holy word, we ask you, O Holy Spirit, to be our teacher, and that you would clearly speak to us through your word. Help us to know how we are to live in a way that honors you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Today we're going to look at three brief principles that will help us to know how we should be living. And this is going to eventually get into Judges chapter 8. We should live, number one, and I hope you write these down, we should live lives that are fully and deeply devoted to God's will. That should be first. That should be first. We should live deeply devoted lives, fully devoted to God's will. Therefore, we want to know what God's will is. He wants to know how we are to be living. What do we do? What do we refrain from doing? We should live lives that are fully and deeply devoted to God's will. Do you know what God's will for your life is? Specifically, the Bible doesn't say, well, Jeff Wilson, 1077 Woodmont Avenue, Meadville, Pennsylvania, 16335. This is what you are to do today. We look in the Bible, we think, God, I'd love to read that someday, wouldn't you? That God makes it that clear. But it is His principles for people, for the church, for people, are still pretty clear. He doesn't assign our name to it, but it's for us. It's for us. So we should live lives that are fully and deeply devoted to God's will. Micah chapter 6, this is the one that came to mind. There's probably 10,000 verses in the Bible that have to do something with God's will or what God wants or what God's telling us. But this is what Micah chapter 6 and verse 6 through 8 says. And you'll recognize this at the very end of it. Micah 6 verse 6 says, well, what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before Him with burnt offerings and a calf a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Should I give my firstborn for my own transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? And then the answer. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what the Lord's will is, or what the Lord requires of you. That is, to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. To do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. Jesus reflects on that very principle in Matthew 23 and verse 23. Jesus was speaking to the religious leaders and he was chiding them a bit. But he was speaking to the religious leaders of his day and he says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites. For you tithe mint." This is edible products, you know. "You tithe mint and dill and cumin, yet have neglected the weightier matters of the law, that is, justice, mercy, and faith," or faithfulness in our relationship to God. Very much connected with Malachi chapter 6, verse 8. Do justly, love mercy or loving kindness, and be faithful, or have a life of faithfulness, walking in fellowship with the Lord. Today we're looking at Gideon's. After last Sunday, it's kind of hard to say this. Gideon's pride, his anger, his rage, his revenge, and his violence. Today, the example is what not to do. Last Sunday, we looked at Gideon. This is how we should live. This is a great example of being a peacemaker. And we prayed, "God, make me like that." Well, today, I hope we'll say, "Lord, don't ever let me get like that. Don't ever let me live like Gideon did, or act like Gideon did, or treat people like Gideon did." So after, if we recall, after Gideon became the answer to the Israelites' prayer, God chose Gideon, and God said, "Choose some men from amongst you," and it wound up being 300 warriors. And with those 300 warriors, God was going to use Gideon to ward off 135,000 Midianites, Amalekites, and the people of the east, the ones that have been ravaging and pillaging their lives, their villages, every day for 7 years, until finally they got so frustrated they prayed to the true and the living God. And so Gideon was an answer to God. And after that, there was some contention between Gideon and the Ephraimites. And as a peacemaker, he functioned magnificently last week. But we pick up in verse 4. Judges 8 and verse 4. So after they defeat the armies of the Midianites, Amalekites, and the people of the east, they didn't just mow everybody down. There were some who were destroyed. Many of them ran for their lives, including two kings. After Gideon's contention with his own people, Gideon chased those two kings and the remaining armies. On his way, Gideon came to the Jordan and crossed over, and the 300 men who were with him were exhausted, yet remained pursuing. Verse 5. So he said to the men of Succoth, which is the little place they came to, "Please give loaves of bread to the people who follow me, for they are exhausted, and I'm pursuing after Zeba and Zalmunan," that is those two kings of the Midianites. And the officials of Succoth said, "Are the hands of Zeba and Zalmunan already in your hands that we should give bread to your army?" And Gideon stood there with his mouth wide open. He doesn't say that. But Gideon, in disbelief, said, "Well then," and here's where the table turns. "Well then, when the Lord has given Zeba and Zalmunna to my hand, I will flail your flesh with the thorns of the wilderness and with briars." Ooh. Does this sound like a threat to destroy, or a threat to attempt to live in a way that's devoted to God's will? Oh, you be the judge of that. Apart from his own ego, why would this even be such a big deal to Gideon? God has already whittled his thousands and thousands of men down to 300 men purposely. They have defeated almost 135,000 warriors of the enemy. One might make the statement that Gideon's army was God's army. They were in need of refreshments and sustenance. These groups are not honoring Gideon or God, so Gideon issues these threats. What came to my mind is, if these people don't give them any bread or water, would that thwart the plan of God? Is anything riding on this? No. What's going to happen to God's plan and God's purpose if these people from Succoth refuse to give bread and water and refreshments to Gideon's army? I refuse to believe that that is going to thwart everything that God was going to do through Gideon. What? No bread? No water? No refreshment? Well, let's go home, guys. I guess that's it. At least we made it this far. Of course not. I believe God would have provided another way. You know, he used 300 to defeat 135,000. I'm not sure what he's worried about here. You know, there will always be people to blame or circumstances to excuse our attitudes and our behavior. Gideon is becoming a man of anger, a man of rage, a man of revenge, and a man of violence. The men of Succoth would not give them anything to eat. And he says, I'm going to come back and I'm going to switch you. I'm going to run you through the thorns a like you've never seen. I'm going to thrash your flesh, is how that's presented in the Hebrew Bible. I will thrash your flesh. But he went on. He came to the men of Penuel, verse 8. And from there he went up to Penuel and spoke to them in the same way. In other words, he said, can you give us some food and some water? My men are, our warriors are tired. And the men there answered him the same way the people in Succoth did. And he said to those men, when I come again in peace, I will break down this tower. There was evidently a tower there. So we see Gideon. I don't know if you ever see the old cartoon of I can't remember, I think it was Sylvester or somebody, and he's doing something on one of those cartoons, and he starts getting angry. And this little, his whole body is like a thermometer, and his whole body just comes up, his white belly is red, comes all the way up, and now you can hear boiling water in the background. You know, boiling water, and it's going like this, and the water comes up, and his face gets red, and this gets red, and steam shoots out its ears, and he's mad, and there's a train whistle somewhere going off. You remember that? Surely you've seen that. That's the image I get of Gideon. It's just like, man, it's simmering inside this guy. For some reason, he just can't take this, and it's getting at him. It's simmering, and it's about to blow his stack. And that's kind of what's building in Gideon right now. When I come again, when I come back here, not only am I going to thrash those lowlife people in Succoth, I'm going to tear your tower down. So now the frustration of Gideon is growing. He's met with uncooperation at every point. Are these threats in keeping with living a life that's committed to the will of God? Are these things building and Gideon being challenged to the degree that rage of that man is beginning to overtake him? I believe it's what we're seeing. It's interesting. Thomas Constable writes this: a spirit of regionalism had developed in Israel since the days of Joshua. these Transjordanian Israelites, that is, the group of Israelites that were living on the other side, the far side of the track, so to speak, the other side of the Jordan River. The majority of them was on the west side of the Jordan River, but there were some on the eastern side of the Jordan River. These Transjordanian Israelites are the ones from Succoth and Penuel that just defied Gideon. They showed no sense of brotherhood or national responsibility. Their lack of cooperation illustrates what both Moses and Joshua feared would happen to the Israelites who lived east of the Jordan River. The seeds of national disintegration have been germinated. And so we see that sort of taking place. So, in his bubbling, boiling anger, I can still hear Sylvester's blood boiling in my head. With Gideon's anger, he goes to pursue those two kings that were still had 15,000 warriors with him. He made it and brought back the kings are still with him. All this time, there's still time for his blood to be boiling. That rage, that anger has still not been satisfied, even after capturing these kings. So, we learn, how should we live? So far we learned this. We should live lives devoted to God's will, fully devoted to God's will. Not my will, not my plans, not my temper, but according to what God wants for my life. Point number two, principle number two, we learn. How should we live? We should live lives that display hearts that are clearly directed by God's word. We should live lives that display hearts that are clearly directed by God's word. Committed to God's will, now directed by God's word. It's one thing to know God's word, it's something else to study God's word, it's something else to understand God's word, it's another thing altogether to obey God's word. We can say we've read it. We can say I've studied it. I've been to Bible school. I've been to seminary. I know it. I've studied it. I know what it means. Somebody can read it in the Greek and the Hebrew. But if we're not obeying it, it makes absolutely no difference. The Bible is not some incantation that you say the right words and your life becomes right. It's not some superstition. You know, they have the whole Bible now on a necklace, and on 1/4 inch, some little piece of material, the entire Bible is printed on that 1/4 inch. And you can purchase this. It's got a lovely chain and go around your neck, or you can put on your loved one's bracelet. It makes a lovely little item. What could that possibly matter? Who would possibly think that's going to be meaningful? Just a minute. Let me see if the preacher's coat saying the words correctly. Let me just try to read this and get my jewelers. It's ridiculous. The Word of God is not like that. The Word of God comes from reading it, studying it, understanding it, knowing it, believing it, obeying it. Obeying it. Psalm 128, verse 1 through 2 says, "Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord and who walks in His ways." Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord and walks in His ways. You shall eat the fruit of your labors with your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall go well with you. Sounds like a pretty good outcome, doesn't it? The person who walks in the ways of God is the one who knows what God's will is and is willing to live by it. Who knows what God's word says and is willing to obey it. The fact that we carry it is meaningless. The fact that we have it tattooed on our forehead is meaningless. The fact that we get it on a cute little pendant or a bracelet in a 1/4 inch thing, you know, we got six books to buy, it's meaningless. Somebody's making a few bucks out there somewhere laughing, I'm sure. If we're not living it, if we're not studying it, if we're not obeying it, it's meaningless. It's meaningless. Verse 13, then Gideon the son of Joash returned from the battle with these kings. He's captured these kings. He comes back, and they came to the same men of Succoth. And he stops and he questions some men he found. He said, "Look, these are the kings that you taunted me over. These are the kings, and I already have them. They're in my hands." And you said that if I had them in their hands, I wouldn't need all this stuff. And you taunted me, and you would not give me bread. And we came through here exhausted. The Bible says he took elders of the city and took thorns of the wilderness and briars, and with them he taught the men of Succoth a lesson. So now it's no longer about God. It's about who? It's about Gideon teaching them a thing or two. It says he taught the men a lesson. It was not a lesson on justice. It wasn't a lesson on the holiness of God. It was a lesson that you don't treat Gideon that way and get away with it. That's what he was treating him. That's what he was teaching. That was the lesson. There are many perspectives on what this was intended to mean. I threshed them. I threshed their flesh. Some commentators say this refers to teaching those people a lesson in compassion and being ready to help other warriors who are in need. Some view it as a teaching lesson in warfare that they never mock or discount a warrior of God. Some commentators say Gideon meant this as a way of making real warriors out of those soft men. I don't think so. Others see this as the beginning of the end, not only of Gideon, his slide into destructive behavior, but of the nation of Israel as a whole. Where are those whose hearts display a desire to be directed by God's word? I would say, where are those with Gideon? Where are some of the religious people, the committed people with Gideon, whose hearts were focused on God's word, whose lives were devoted to live according to his will? Where are those people? Somebody at some point should have said, now, Gideon, there's just some of us, we're just not comfortable with what we just did in Succoth. Those guys were pretty badly mangled with those thorns and flesh. Or Gideon, you know, slow down, cool off before you take any action on these people of Penuel. We're kind of going off the deep end here. We're going in a bad direction. Some believe that the threshing, specifically the language of threshing the flesh of those elders and men of Succoth, was what was traditionally done prior. That was a terrorist act leading up to execution. It wasn't just he whipped them like your mom would whip you with a switch. These just happened to have briars on them. Many believe that this was a terrorist, torturous type of treatment ending in their execution. Thirdly, we should live lives that are holy and determined for God's glory. We should live lives that are fully devoted to God's will. We should live lives that display hearts that are clearly directed by his word. And we should live lives that are wholly determined for God's glory. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31 says, whatever you eat or whatever you drink, whatever you do, do everything to the glory of God. That should be the goal and purpose for every person that calls himself a Jew or a Christian. All that we do for the honor and glory of God. Verse 17 of Judges. And when Gideon came back to the men of Penuel, he broke down the tower, and he killed all the men. Again, Thomas Constable says, when the plot resumes in these chapters, something seems to have happened to our character, the hero. In chapters 6 through 7, we have witnessed his transformation from a fearful private citizen to a fearless agent of God, willing to take on the enemy against all odds, not to mention a sensitive diplomat, bringing about peace. But the portrait of the man the author paints in this chapter creates a radically different impression in the reader's mind. If Judges chapter 8, verse 1 through 32, this about what these things Gideon is presently doing, if that had been handed down without the literary context in which it was given, modern readers would reject Gideon as a tyrant and arbitrary in his treatment of the enemy and ruthless in handling his own countrymen. Instead of hacking and contending with the enemy, Gideon, Jerubbaal, contends and hacks his own people. And we've learned that the people God chooses are not always perfect people. In fact, they are never perfect people. They are often even inconsistent people. By the way, the men of Succoth, the men of Penuel, that Gideon tortured and threshed, quite likely executed, and then the men of Penuel, whom he knocked over their tower and executed, massacred them, they were of the tribe of Gad. They were Jewish people, Jewish remnants, Jewish-related people. And so these Bible scholars are saying Gideon has gone from being a man to be feared by his enemies to a man who's feared by his own countrymen. How should we live? We should live lives devoted to God's will, who have hearts directed by God's word, and whose purpose is that we be determined, our purpose of life be determined by the glory of God. By the glory of God. Just a couple of things and we'll get out of here. I'm sorry we're running a little bit late. Romans chapter 12, verse 18 and 19 says, if possible, as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all people. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave the wrath to God. You might say, well, that's the New Testament. What Gideon did was in the Old Testament, okay? Deuteronomy chapter 32, that's the Old Testament. That's what Gideon would have been living by. Deuteronomy 32, verse 35, vengeance is mine and is recompense for the time when their foot shall slip, for the day of their calamity is at hand and their doom comes swiftly. Vengeance is mine. Recompense is mine. Proverbs 20, verse 22, never say, I will repay evil. Wait for the Lord and he will deliver. Proverbs 24, verse 29, do not say, I will do to him as he has done to me. I will pay the man back for what he has done. These are all Old Testament scripture verses that should somehow have come to Gideon or somebody who was with him. Gideon, you know what? God's word, we're getting real concerned. God's word clearly says that we don't act this way, even against enemies. This is just not appropriate. 1 Peter 3, 9, do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on contrary, bless, for to this you are called, that you may obtain a blessing. You know, our battles are not with people. Our enemies, our battles are not with enemies who must be defeated. Our enemy is Satan. And our battles are battles to win the lost, to reach souls for Christ. That is our battle. That's what Satan wants to distract us from. Once God's people begins fighting between themselves, we have begun to destroy ourselves and the ministry to which God has called us to. So I would like to close with this. One day you're going to read that old Jeff Wilson is getting buried next week. One day you'll read, did I hear a hoot and holler? Oh, I'm sorry, I thought I heard a murmur of rejoicing back there. You're going to read that Jeff Wilson is dead and in the grave. And you may even attend my funeral. It's going to be interesting because at my funeral, I've chosen two things. It's already planned out. That the gospel message be proclaimed and an invitation given. And if that doesn't happen, I'll rise up and do it myself. If the Lord will allow it. Secondly, this song is going to be played. We already sang it. This song is going to be played, but with a little bit higher volume at the funeral. I Want to Live Like That by Sidewalk Prophets. That was the song we sang here. Sometimes I think, what will people say when I'm only a memory? When my soul is home where I belong. Was I love when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of those? Was my worship more than just a song? I want to live like that and give it all I have so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand. Recklessly abandoned, never holding back, I want to live like that. I want to live like that. Am I proof that you are who you say you are? That grace can really change a heart? Do I live like your love is true? People pass. And even if they don't know my name, is there evidence that I've been changed? When they see me, do they see you? I want to show the world the love that you gave to me. I'm longing for the world to know the glory of our King. I want to live like that and give it all I have so that everything I say and do points to you. I want to live like that. Holy Father, we come to you in our prayer today, Lord. It was, make me a peacemaker last week. Lord, today our prayer, my prayer, Lord, is whatever it takes, wherever it takes me, may Jesus Christ live through me, that my heart would be devoted to your word, that I would seek to live by your holy word and to know your will and to live that out every day of my life until you call me home. Help us to pray that prayer, and we look for you to answer it in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you for sticking with us today. After the service, if anybody would like prayer for anything in your life, we would love to be here. We'll be here to pray with you. We'd love to pray with you confidentially if that's what you need. If you'd like to talk, you'll talk more and know more about a relationship with Jesus Christ, or how you can more effectively live like God wants you to live, we'd love to be able to talk to you about that as well. Please remember, just a few minutes after the end of the worship service, the Vacation Bible School meeting will be in the back of the sanctuary. And please, please be thinking of praying that prayer this week. Lord, I want to be someone whose heart is devoted to you, whose life is living according to your word, who's seeking and living out your holy will for your honor and for your glory. Lord, we thank you, and Lord, we thank you for your holy word. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for your will and purpose that's on every life of every person here today. Help us to be living lives that evidence that we are following you, trusting you, and living for you. And we'll thank you for it in Christ's name. Amen.